Number one, we learn about God so much in the last 5 Sundays. What did we learn about God? Number one, write this down. We learn that it's all about God. Everybody say, it's all about God. It's all about God. It's not about you. It's not about me. It's not about us. It's all about God. This is what the Bible says. Hebrews 2:10, everybody. God is the one who made all things, and all things are for His glory. There you go. Circle the words, all things. Ano ibig sabihin ng all things? You and me included. Everyone. We exist. We live on this earth. We were made by God. For what now? For His glory. So, brothers and sisters in Christ, this is a sobering reminder for us. Kasi many times in life, lalo na when we were young, and for those who are young today, the 20-something, the millennials, you know, early in life, we make it our ambition and goal to what? To be happy, to be fulfilled, right? To be comfortable, to be successful, to fulfill our personal dreams, ambitions, and goals. Well, there's nothing wrong with having an ambition. There's nothing wrong with setting goals. There's nothing wrong with having money or being fulfilled and being successful in work. But the Bible is reminding us, those are not the main thing. The main thing that God put you on this earth is what? For His glory. It's all about God. We were made by God for God. Not to find happiness and joy and comfort in this world. We exist because God wanted us to exist. For what purpose? For His glory. We were made for Him. Brothers and sisters in Christ, I like to remind you that this truth number one is one of the most basic and essential truth that if you really believe this truth, you will be able to avoid many of the emotional pain, many of the problems about life. What am I saying? I'm not saying that your life will be perfect, but I'm saying is once you really believe inside you that it's not about you, it's all about God, then even if bad things happen in your life, even if things turn out not the way you wanted them to be, when you believe that it's not about you, that it's all about God and His will and His way and His glory, then you can take these things. You can take these things. Problems will not cause you to be afraid or to worry. People issues, if you have relational issues with a spouse, with children, with parents, with workmates, people issues and failures cannot cause you to be angry or resentful. If you think about yourself, if you think it's all about you, then people issues will cause you to be impatient and angry. But when you realize it's all about God and you're here to glorify God, in your behavior, in how you respond, in how you relate to people, then you discover you don't have to stress yourself because it's not about you. When people criticize you, it can make you feel angry or insecure, right? But when you realize it's not about you, people can say all kinds of bad things about you, and it will not affect you. If you really believe, you are here for God and His glory. Being unappreciated sometimes at work or in relationships between husband and wife or children or overlooked has the tendency to make you feel jealous if you think it's about you. But if you really believe, it's not about you, it's about God. And you're here for His glory, you exist for His glory, for His will, then you can get over it, right? Your past failures Your faults, your frailties in life can make you feel insecure or maybe self-pity if you think it's about you. But once you believe it's not about you, it's about God, then past failures cannot keep you feeling down and guilty all the time. You have stubborn kids. Amen ba? How many parents have stubborn kids? If you have stubborn kids and they cause you to lose your cool, because naman syempre, if you're thinking it's all about you, and you have kids who disobey and do not listen to you, then you start thinking, aba, aba, walang respeto sa akin. Walang paggalang sa akin. Walang tamang takot sa akin. When you think it's all about you lose your cool. But when you really believe it's not about you, then, yes, Noah, nothing can make you lose your cool, right? You don't get your way. And sometimes when you don't get what you want, it can cause you to be impatient with people. You start to think, oh man, this is how you treat me. And, you know, you don't follow me. If you think it's all about you, that is what will happen. But when you really believe, it's not about you. It's about God and glorifying God with how you respond to situations and how you relate to people, no matter what. Then you will never be impatient or lose your cool. So what I'm trying to say, mga kapatid, is this. When you think about it, the root cause na pinanggagalingan ng lahat ng negative emotion is from the belief that it's about us. So you change that belief into what the Bible says, that you and I are here, we were made by God, we exist, not for our satisfaction, comfort, and fulfillment of whatever desires we have, but we are here for God to serve His will and His way and glory. Nothing can turn your emotion negative because it's not about me. It's all about God. When you think about it, that's the first lesson. If you really want to be happy, this is it. This is the key. Just believe it's not about you. Whatever life throws at you, nothing will ever destroy the way you respond as God wants you to respond. Number two, what else did we learn about God? Number two, write this down. God still does miracles. We learned in the last five Sundays that God is still doing miracles. Miracles did not end during the New Testament times. He still does miracles. Psalm 77, basa, you are the God of miracles and wonders. You still demonstrate your awesome power. Everybody say, awesome! That is how we should regard God. He is an awesome God, awesome power, miracle-working God. He is in a miracle business. Can you imagine in the last five Sundays in our series, two or three Sundays ago, Ate Joy approached me and said, you know, Pas, I'm willing to be part of the core in shaping the small group life of our church. It's a miracle! You know, Tita Banji, my dear beloved one, at the end of 2016, she said something that bothered my heart. She said, I don't think I want to continue small grouping in 2017. But two Sundays ago in our series, she came to me, Pastor Joe, the word of God just spoke to my heart. We should continue. Keep on with our small. It's a? Parang ulong. Come on, it's a? Amen. That Ray is still awake. It's a miracle. Awesome. I'm happy, Ray. I see you're listening. Wow. Do you know that 2 weeks ago in our ministry sign-up fair, 33 new volunteers signed up. It's a miracle. You see, God is a miracle-working God. Many of you are going to make a commitment for 2017 budget, and you're going to do it beyond what your usual tithe is. If you do that, that will be a miracle. There will be a miracle of generosity as we campaign for tithes this year. Lives are changed when people realize. See this? Lives are changed when people realize it's not about us. It's all about God, His will, and His way. And we are all here to just listen and follow His leading. Amen? So at this point, I will invite you, in front of you, in the pouch in front of you, there are what we call pledge cards. It's February. For those of you first-timers, you don't have to be pressured by this, but for those of you who have been here, you're members of the church, will you please get that pledge card? And at this point, I'd like you to prayerfully fill that up and make a commitment to support the ministry of ICA for 2017. Huh? He's a miracle-working God, and we're going to expect a miracle of generosity today. Lives will be changed today as people make a pledge and a commitment to give for the budget. Come on, fill that up prayerfully, and then later on in the offering, drop it there. Okay? All right. So please do that. Now, let's go on to point number two. What have we learned about life in this series? We learned, number one, that life is a preparation for eternity. That's why we're here. That's why when Jesus saved us and washed away our sins, the Bible says, by faith, we receive God's grace, our sins are forgiven, we are reconciled to God, we are assured of a home in heaven. Tanong, sigurado na pala tayong pupunta sa langit. Why doesn't God take us now? Right? Oy, pastor, ayoko pa, hindi pa kami nag-asawa. No, but you know, the thing is, why doesn't God take us out? Why? Because He wants us to be prepared for heaven. There are some preparations we need to go through and pass while we are here on earth. That is what life... If someone asks you, what is the meaning of life? This is one of the best answers. Life is a preparation for eternity. For eternity. We are here on earth for a short time. Well, the Bible says He designed us to be with Him forever. Where do we find that? One of the verses in the Bible, Ecclesiastes chapter 3, verse 11. Let's read together, everybody. God has planted what? Eternity in the human heart. Meaning, even if you're not a Christian, even if you don't read the Bible, every human being will have in his heart that sense that he is destined not just for this earth matter, planet earth alone. You notice that wherever you go in this world, even in the most remote places and tribes, not reached by Christian mission, you will discover people of different cultures, even the most remotest, still have a way of worshiping and acknowledging that there is a supreme being. Where is it? What is it? This is what it says. God has planted eternity in the human heart. You know, when you really, when you understand this, that you were made by God to be with Him forever, you know what will happen? Nothing, no situation, no matter how bad or how sad, can steal your sense of significance. You will never ever feel worthy, no matter what people say, no matter what happens to you, no matter what failures you will encounter in life, if you just believe that the God who made everyone and everything desires you to be with Him forever in eternity, you will always feel worthy, you will always feel significant. Because you realize, even if people turn their backs on you, the God of the universe wants you forever. He wants you to be with Him forever. All right? And the Bible says, when you give your life to God through Jesus Christ, and sabi sa Bible, nothing can separate you from the love of God. He wants you to be with Him for eternity. Life on earth, what we do here is to prepare us to be with Him. Number two, what else have we learned about life? Life, we were put here on earth for five purposes. We were put here on earth for five purposes. So it's a preparation. And how do we prepare? By doing the five. Fulfilling the five purposes. Proverbs 16:4. Let's read together. The Lord has made everything that includes you and me for His purpose. What have we learned so far in this series? We learned that God made you for five, not six, not three, five purposes, right? You may forget everything I said. You may forget me. Do not forget the five. Work on balancing the five for the rest of your life. Let's review them. What are the five? Number one, I was planned for God's pleasure. What's the word in the Bible for that? Worship. That's purpose number one. To worship God, to know God and love God. Number two, I was what? Formed for God's family. What do we call that? When you're learning to love people, believers like family, that's called fellowship. That's what we're here to do. Number three, we were created to become like Christ in character. And what's the Bible word for that? It's called discipleship. Number three, purpose number three. Purpose number four, we were shaped to serve God. What's the Bible word for that? Ministry. Yes. Ministry is basically using the gifts that God has given you to serve others. That's ministry. Every believer, if you're using your gifts to serve others, you are a minister. And number five. Purpose number five, we were made for a mission. And what's the Bible word for doing missions? It's called evangelism. Those are the five purposes of life. Those are the five reasons why God put us on this planet. A lot of people are addicted. A lot of people are in prison. A lot of people are struggling in their life, in trouble. Why? Because they did not know that they were made for a purpose. And what's the result? Not knowing their purpose, they threw their lives away. They wasted their lives away. It makes a lot of difference when a person realizes and really believes that God has made him for a purpose. And here in this series, we clarified it that there are how many? Five purposes that we were made by God to live for. Now let's talk about growing. What have we learned about growing? We learned about growing that people grow through commitments. People grow when they make a promise, when they make a commitment, when they make a commitment. You know, Gino was one of the most mature young adults in our church, the most mature eligible bachelor in years past here in ICA. But that was him, 20s, early 20s, mid-20s, late-20s, most mature, eligible bachelor. But when he made a vow before Lara to be her loving, faithful, and loving, faithful, and helpful husband, that just elevated Gino from one level of existence to the next. to commit his life to Lara. People grow when they do what they believe. People do what they believe when they make a promise. So it starts with commitment. That's why in our classes, 101, 201, 301, 401, after we teach the lesson, we ask people, do you commit? Because once they say, I commit to Christ and the church, that takes them to another level. When they say, I commit to doing the disciplines, small group, tithing, and prayer, that takes them to the next level. That God and other people around them can hold them accountable. When they commit to serve, sign up, 33, that brings those 33 to the next level of their spiritual journey. We had people sign up for missions, that brings them to the next level. When they make a commitment, when we ask you to get a pledge card, you would say, why do I have to fill up a pledge card? I come to church anyway. Why can't I just give when I am here? You know why? Because when you write on a pledge card, you commit. This amount I give, check if it's weekly, check if it's monthly or whatever. And then you sign your name. You are making a commitment to give, to be like God, be a giver, to be generous giver, to be a faithful, consistent giver. And do you know how you can test if that is happening? You look at the back of your pledge card at the end of the year. And if you see a lot of checks and signature, then you can say, God, this year I have grown more mature, more consistent, more generous, more faithful. But when you look at the back of your pledge card and it has a lot of jumping blanks, then you know. You made a commitment at the beginning of the year, but you are still struggling and growing in that area of your spiritual journey. Correct? That's why it's so important to help people make commitments. Because before people can really practice the word, you have to make them understand. And when they understand, you have to make them commit. And when they commit, then you can check on them and hold them responsible for what they committed. James chapter 2, basa. Faith by itself, if it is not accompanied by actions, is dead. What is the Bible saying? The Bible is simply saying that Bible lessons that we get from Bible study or that you hear from the pulpit are meant to be practiced. They are not meant to be listened to and just amuse you. They are meant to be acted upon. And how do you act? How does a person act on what they learn? When they make a promise, a commitment, right? Last year, 50 made a promise in class 101 to give their life to Christ and be part of the church. 2 weeks ago, 33, for the first time, signed up to serve and volunteer in the ministries of the church. And I, with this trend and momentum, I am expecting hundreds of people will, you know, just in the years grow in ministry. And if last year we were able to send 37 people to do mission in Palawan, if we could double that or triple that number for people who are going on mission in Mindanao this year. How do people act on what they have learned? When you help them make a what? Commitment. Make a commitment. Number two, what have we learned about growing up, maturing? Well, here's number two. People grow through fellowship. People grow through fellowship. You can never grow simply by studying by yourself, by reading the Bible yourself. You can know the Bible from cover to cover, But if you are not with people, you cannot grow as God wants you to grow. You see, everything that God wants you to do involves people. Have you noticed how many purposes does God have for your life, my life? 5. Have you noticed 4 out of the 5 involves people? Worship is towards God, but fellowship, people. Discipleship, with people. Serving, people. Sharing, people. 4 out of the 5 things that God expects us to do while we are here on earth involves people. So guess what? You may memorize the Bible from cover to cover, attend Bible studies every day, like Monday, ICA Bible study, Tuesday, GCF Bible study, Wednesday, CCF, Thursday, Victory, Friday, New Life Bible study. But if you do not like people, you miss the point. You miss the point. Spiritual growth comes when you learn to relate to people as Christ relates to people. That's how spiritual growth comes. I may be away, but if you just keep on doing small groups and making sure 2017 and onwards, every attender of ICA is connected to a fellowship, a small group, this is the promise, Philippians 4:9. Let's read together, basa. Keep on doing the things that you have learned and received and heard. And what's the promise? If you keep on doing the 5 purposes that you have learned in this series, what's the promise? Basa together. And the God of peace will be with you. Wow. So keep on fellowshipping, keep on being in small groups, stay in your small group or start a new small group or join a small group. And what's the promise? You will experience the peace, the deep peace of God, that no matter what life throws you, you will never lose your balance or focus. All right? Don't give up. In Hebrews chapter 10, it's not in your notes, verse 25, we are reminded, let us not forget the what? The habit of gathering together with other believers. So don't stop fellowshipping. Right? You will need it. We all need it if we really want to grow. Okay? What else have we learned? Community. What have we learned about community in this series? Who do we mean by saying community? We mean the unchurched. People who are not engaged or connected in their spiritual life to a church. What have we learned in this series, The Purpose of Life from the Bible, about the community that we are surrounded with, the unchurched people? Well, this is what we learned. Write this down. We have learned that people, the unchurched, are hungry for spiritual truth. People are hungry, the unchurched, meaning they are just waiting for you to share to them the truth that there is a God, and this God loves them, and this God has a plan and purpose for their life. They are just waiting to be introduced. That's why ICA stands for I introduce. Why do we exist as a church? We are here to introduce people to God and His purpose. And people out there, they're just waiting. That's what Jesus said. They are waiting. Basa, John chapter 4. What did Jesus say? Everybody, look, basa, look around you. Vast fields of human souls are ripening all around us and are ready for reaping. Jesus said this 2,000 years ago and it is still true today. It doesn't matter what village you come from, Moonwalk, BF, Pilar, Ayala, Alabang, Condo, Aspen, or Madrigal Business Park, T.S. Cruz, Daang Ha, wherever you live, Muntin Lupa, Paranaque, Las Piñas, people around you, Jesus said, look around you. People are just waiting to hear an invitation that there is a God who loves them and that this God has a plan and purpose for your life. They are all around you. They are just waiting. Think about this, brothers and sisters in Christ. Think about this. When you see me with Bible in hand, teaching from the Bible, or no Bible, and talking to people about how God loves them and has a purpose for their life, if I do it, people around me will say, of course, that's his job. He's paid to do that. Right? But think about this. When people see you talking to people, conversing with them, sharing with them about a God who loves them and has five purposes for them, you see the effect? You have more powerful, convincing power than I have when we reach out to the community. You are the church's most powerful untapped resource in sharing the good news and bringing the community into the body of Christ. But you know why? How can that happen? How can that time happen when people who know God and His purpose will actually share when you realize that the people are hungry for spiritual truth? Jesus said this, around you, look, there are souls ready for reaping. This is your calling, brothers and sisters. This is not just the task of the pastor. Sabi ni Jesus sa kanyang followers, you will be my witnesses. That's you and me. If the church, the people of God, will just believe that the unchurched are waiting to be invited, are waiting to be shared the love of God, ICA will grow and will just keep on growing. And, you know, in leaps and bounds, you cannot hold people. That's what's needed. Church, remember this. Maturity is not an end in itself. Why does God want us to mature? Why do you think? Why does God want you and me to go through discipleship and become mature? Maturity is not an end in itself. The purpose why God wants you and me to mature, to grow up, is what? So we can be used by Him in ministry and in mission. A lot of Christians make the mistake that the Christian life is all about attending Bible studies. So every night of the week, one Bible study after another, they attend to all the seminars and conferences of the Bible and the church they attend to. But guess what? If you never serve others and you never bring a soul to Christ, you miss the point. Maturity is not an end in itself. So brothers and sisters, He wants us to serve. And that is what ICA is all about. ICA, we say, what is our purpose? We are here, I, to introduce people to God and His purpose. E, once they have accepted God and His purpose, we embrace them like a family, fellowship. And once we embrace them, we do not stay embraced. We coach them, we guide them, we encourage them, we live beside them, all right? We don't teach, just teach. We live beside. We use the word coach, and it's so wonderful why Aika is spelled this way, because coaching makes disciples. So we coach them to maturity, and then A, so they can serve in the ministry and mission, and therefore what? Advance A, the kingdom of God, the will of God, the way of God. That's what we're here for. And if you believe in your heart that you want to support that kind of church, then give. Give your tithes. Give your offerings. Because this is what you're supporting. What now? What now? Everybody say, what now? What do we do? Now that we know God's five purposes for making us and putting us on this earth, what now? Number one, I submit to you that we have to start living what we've learned. Tagalog pa, ipamuhay natin ang ating natutunan. Let's start living what we've learned. God put us on this earth for a purpose. Let's practice those purposes. And you have the rest of your living life to practice, to do them, right? John chapter 13, basa everybody. Now that you know these things. Wow. You know what? You have known God's five purposes for making you. God's five purposes for making you. Now that you know these things, basa, you will be blessed if you do them. A lot of people pray every day, every morning, please bless my day, please bless my work, please bless my children. You want God's blessing in your life? Here it is. The condition of God is simple. Now that you know what His purpose is for putting you on this earth, do them. Do them. Right? Because the blessing of God comes not in knowing them, but in doing them. Do them. You now know the five purposes of God, but the blessing comes in doing the purposes of God. Put your hands and feet into it. Look at what Paul says, Ephesians 5:15. Live life with a due sense of responsibility. Tapikin mo yung katabi mo. Sabi mo, be responsible. That's what Paul is saying. I want you to be responsible. Live life with a due sense of responsibility. Basa, what does he mean? Basa, not as those who do not have an idea, who do not know the meaning of life, the purpose of life. But Paul says, live as those who do, as those who know. You see, Paul is saying, now that you know, you will be held responsible by God. Live with due sense of responsibility. As people who know your purpose for living, do them. Because God will call you to accounting. God will hold you responsible. You know, for many people, even in Aika, maybe before you learn the five purposes of God, before you just receive Jesus Christ as your Savior because you want to be sure that you're not going to hell, right? But if you're honest, you're living for money. You're living for sex. You're living for pleasure. You're living for popularity. What Paul is saying, if you know now why God put you on this earth, worship, fellowship, discipleship, ministry, and mission. What's he saying? Do not go back to your old life where you're only thinking of what will make you happy, what will make you comfortable, what will fill your pockets, or what will give you pleasure. He's saying, Do not go back to that old life, but fulfill God's purpose for your life. Why? Because God will hold you responsible. You know the meaning of life. What's the meaning of life? Number one, I know that I am planned for God's pleasure. Therefore, worship God. Know God and love God even more from every day. Number two, you know that you were formed for God's family. Therefore, learn to love other believers like family. To treat them with respect and kindness and mercy and grace as Jesus would. Number three, God made you what? Created you to become like Christ. Therefore, grow up in character and manifest love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, and self-control. Number four, you now know that you were shaped to serve God. Therefore, use your talents, your time, your energy, your resources to what? To serve other people, because when you serve them, you serve God. You now know, number five, that you were made for a mission. So, share the good news. Don't just act like nothing happened. Don't just let 2017 go. You know the five purposes, and December 2017, 31 will come, and not a single soul you have brought to Jesus Christ. Paul is saying, now that you know why God put you on this earth, live with a due sense of responsibility. Practice them. Do them. Live them out. Philippians chapter 3, basa everybody. Now that we are on the right track, let's stay on. Stay on. Right? Stay on. Everybody stay, say, stay on. Friends, brothers and sisters in Christ, now that you know the five purposes, the first thing I'm going to leave to you, challenge you, is what? Stay on. Or keep on. Keep on doing the five purposes individually. Keep on doing the five purposes together as a church. To help you stay on the five purposes, I urge you to buy a copy of the book, The Purpose-Driven Life. And make it a habit that when the year begins, the whole of January, you will read through the book and just review so that again, you are refreshed as to what are God's five purposes for your life. Number two, I urge you, if you are to stay on and keep on, finish the classes. If you've been here in ICA all these years and you've never taken the classes, take all the classes, 101, 201, 301, and 401. Make it your goal in 2017 to just study and know and learn all these classes that we offer. So number one, keep on. Just keep on and stay on. Number two, what do we do now? Now that we know God's purpose, number two, pass it on. Pass it on. Pass it on to others. 2 Timothy chapter 2, verse 2. What does it say? Everybody? Now, I want you to tell these same things to who? To followers who can be trusted to tell others. Trusted. Circle the word trusted. Look at the person beside you. Can that person be trusted? How do you know that a person can be trusted? According to this verse, one of the signs that a person can be trusted is what? They tell others. Circle the word, tell others. Brothers and sisters in Christ, this 2017, do not let January to December go without telling others about God and His love and His purpose for their lives. Be a trusted follower of Jesus Christ. One who tells others. You see, trustworthy people are people who share what they have been given. Diba, may kasabihan tayo? Hurt people, hurt people. Well, the opposite is also true. Love people, love people. Blessed people, bless people. Save people, save people. If you want God's blessing in your life, the more you give away, the more God blesses you. So, pass it on. Amen? It could be a simple text telling someone about God's love or His purpose and plan. It could be, you could do this by giving them a copy of the book, The Purpose of Life. Whatever it takes, we are to pass it on. Brothers and sisters in Christ, I am proud of all of you. The last 15 years has been a meaningful, fruitful, growing, exciting ministry with all of you. And when I think about you, I will always think of Romans 1:8. Let's read together. I thank my God through Jesus Christ for every one of you because news of your faith is spreading throughout the whole world. I declare, if we just keep on and pass it on, ICA will continue to grow and expand. Your unselfishness will be heard of. Your love for people will get their attention. And your giving will exceed expectations. Keep on, pass it on.